The physiographic divisions of India, as we all know, there are major five physiographic divisions. Usually, when we think of tectonics as the criteria for division of India, we can have three major groups. One group is called as the Himalayan group, which is associated with the tectonic activity of Indian plate and Eurasian plate. The second part or the second area is the Indo-Gangetic plane, which was previously a trough between the Deccan Plateau or the older landmass and the Eurasian or the Himalayan landmass that was very newly constructed. And the third division is called as Deccan Plateau, which is supposed to be the shield area or the area that is the one of the oldest parts of the land mass produced on the earth. So these three are the major divisions associated with tectonics. But now, as far as the physiography or the relief feature is concerned, we can divide India into five major groups. One is called as the Himalayan division. Second is the Indo-Gangetic plain. Now, instead of calling it as Indo-Gangetic plain, usually it is referred to as the Northern Great Plains. Then we have a Deccan Plateau or the plateau proper. The fourth division is the coastal plain of India, and fifth are the islands. So there are five major physiographic divisions of India. Now, when we think of these five divisions, you will come across, or you will very easily come to know, that they have five different processes of their origin. As far as the India is concerned, the prime landmass or the main or the original landmass is the Deccan Plateau, because this is a part of the Gondwana land, which was the shield area or which was part of the proto-continent known as Pangaea, as far as the Wegener's theory is concerned. And if we go by the plate tectonics, it was part of the Indian plate. And this Indian plate consists of Indian Ocean and both the Arabian Sea and Bay of Bengal, which are the promontories of Indian Ocean. And they and the southern India, they usually or they previously made what is called as Indian plate. Now, this Indian plate was moving and it collided with the Eurasian plate. This collision was responsible for raising of the sea that was present in between these two or at the plate margin in previous days. And this raising of the seabed produced Himalayas. So, Himalayas have their origin in what is called as collision of plate boundaries as far as the plate tectonic theory is concerned. And this collision of plate boundaries was not a one incident, but it continued for long, and it is said that even it continues till today. So this collision and subsequent secondary shifting or what is called as moving of Indian plate has produced Himalayan chain. Now, Himalayan chain consists of three major divisions. As we know, the foothills, which are known as Shivaliks, the central Himalayan ranges, which are broken. For example, we have Jaskars and Pir Panjal, and the greater Himalayan range, which we also called as Himadri. So this is the mountain system. This is one of the loftiest mountain systems of the world and very recent mountain systems of the world. Not only that, this is a largest continuous chain of mountains, we can say, because it not only continues in Himalaya, but it has got its promontories in China in form of the Tian Shan mountain systems. In present day, Pakistan and Pak-occupied Kashmir, Karakoram system, and beyond that in Afghanistan and Pakistan border areas, we have Hindu Kush system. On the eastern side, it continues as Arakan Yoma in Myanmar, and there are some parts in Tibet. So, as a system together, it is one of the largest systems. And we get loftiest mountains, we get more than 14 peaks above 8000 meters in Himalayas. So, this is the one physiographic division. Now, this division is known for its azonal kind of alpine vegetation. It means that the vegetation is not actually the vegetation of this latitude, but it is because of the altitude that we get vegetation. So, this is the Himalayan system. Then we have, we previously had a trough between the original landmass of Deccan Plateau and the Himalaya that was newly produced, and this trough was east-west prolongation, and this trough was subsequently filled up by the sediment brought by rivers from Himalayas, because as we know, we have perennial rivers in Himalayas, and Himalaya on other hand is a sedimentary formation, and that is why it is very brittle. So lot of material was brought by all the rivers that were flowing from Himalayas, and this material was used to fill up this trough, and this filling was done by the systems or the tributaries of three major rivers. One is the Indus, second is the Ganges, and third is Brahmaputra. So all these three rivers, they have their origin in Himalayas, and additionally there are major tributaries of all these three rivers. So the river systems of Indus, Ganga and Brahmaputra, they brought the sediment, and it was deposited in this trough like portion, and that deposition produced what we presently called as Indo-Gangetic Plain. Now it is better known as the Northern Great Plain, because it also includes the plains produced by Brahmaputra. So they start right from Jammu, where we have plains. I mean, it's part of Kashmir, but still we have plains in Jammu, and they continue up to the Assam Valley, and they abruptly end at the head of the Assam Valley near Parshuram Kund. So this is the extent of the Indo-Gangetic Plain, and they usually have a crescent shape because they follow the Himalayan systems. They also receive the sediments from the southern plateau, but because the rivers are not so strong, they are not perennial, and they hardly have any strong water system, and because the rocks are very hard, the sediment received from southern plains is very small. So this is what is usually, or in short, we can describe the Indo-Gangetic Plains. The third major chunk is the Deccan Plateau. Now, Deccan Plateau was the original landmass of India. Now, the volcanic activity which produced the first land on this earth was also responsible for generation of Deccan Plateau. And the rocks of Deccan Plateau, they date back to the one of the oldest rocks, which are called as Archean series rocks. So you have Deccan basalts and Deccan granites, which are overlain on the Archean rocks. Now this Deccan Plateau is a raised plateau, but it is not only raised, it is slightly inclined, and it has got inclination towards the east. So you have a sharp edge on the west, and towards east you have a rolling slopes. So this Deccan Plateau is made up of basically the igneous rocks. In some places these igneous rocks are made modified or metamorphosed due to either climate or some smaller tectonic activities, like you have faults or you have localized folding activity, but majority of the rocks are basalt. And this is one of the most unaltered part of India, and this is drained by the rivers, like Narmada is one of the river, and then you have Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, which are the major rivers draining the Deccan Plateau. So Deccan Plateau is by extent one of the largest physiographic division of India, which is in continuity. A part of Deccan Plateau is also found in Meghalayas. The Ganga and Brahmaputra together have cut the Deccan Plateau, and they passed towards Bangladesh when there was rupture of the Deccan Plateau due to the collision. And you get continuation of Deccan Plateau in Meghalayas, especially in Garo and Khasi or Shillong Plateau. And there are corresponding coal seams in Chotanagpur and Shillong Plateau. So this is the third division of India. And fourth is the coastal plains. Now coastal plains are separated only because altitudinally they are different, and secondly because climatically they are different. But the western coastal plains are altogether different from the eastern coastal plains. And you will find that technically all land which is having altitude of less than 100 meters is called as coastal plain. But sometimes we keep this norm aside, and we have some region marked as plain having some higher altitude also. So this is about the coastal plains. Now the coastal plains are rugged or hilly in case of western coastlines, and they are more depositional in case of eastern coastlines. And the fifth major physiographic division, now this is not major by extent, but this is major because it's different and it is strategically significant, is the islands of India. Now there are two different major groups of islands in India. One group is called as Arabian Sea group. Now this group is made up of coral deposits. So almost all the islands in Arabian Sea are because of coral deposits. So they are low lying, atoll like, and they are characterized by sedimentary formations, and these are the characteristics because of their own formation. The exception to this is Deev Island, which is a major island on the coast of Gujarat, and it is not at all a coral island. It's a continental kind of island. That is the exception. There are many rocks which emerge out of seas very near to the coastline, and such chain of rocks is seen from central Maharashtra up to central Karnataka, or rather south Karnataka even. So you have Nivti rocks, you have Saint Islands and all those kind of things on the western coast. The Andaman group of islands and the Nicobar group of islands are called as Bay of Bengal group of islands. Now these islands are volcanic in origin, and they are also called as continental islands because they are the part of near shore continental shelf, and these are the parts of continental shelves which have emerged out of the oceanic waters. So this is how we can divide India into five major physiographic divisions. Now as far as the exams are concerned, or as far as the question pattern is concerned, for a general description of physiographic divisions, we have to relate them to the formation, the process of formation, and second is, of course, we have to think of their strategic significance. Why and how the Himalayas are significant, and what role exactly they play in case of Indian climate, Indian drainage, etc. So this is how we can relate all these major five divisions with other factors.